Okay. Hello. And as you all may have noticed if you watched my little announcement that was posted either yesterday or the day before, this is a more or less brand new podcast. I'm starting over with episode 1. I'm giving it a new name. We're doing some reorganization. We're going to introduce some new tidbits into the podcast as well. So, since this is technically a new podcast, welcome. Hello. Thanks for coming to check it out. And I'm Devin. You can find me on Ravelry as Devi0894, and I'll put that here. And you can find me on Instagram as MissyD1206, and that will also go here. There's a Ravelry group. I have a whopping 15 members from the previous podcasting shenanigans, and I would love it if you would come and join. I'm thinking about making it a little bit more active if I can, so yeah. I have served roughly 4 years in the National Guard here in Texas. I am living just under an hour northeast of Dallas, and I work for my parents' self-defense company. We teach people to defend themselves with and without firearms. We teach the class that is required by the state of Texas for licensing, and we, Lord, my glasses are so lopsided, it's ridiculous. We teach classes that are based on some really instinctive, really, really simple techniques that don't require a whole lot of thinking. And don't require a whole lot of finesse, because in a real life situation, it basically comes in and it basically turns into gross motor movements. So you have more or less this kind of thing going on. You can swing, but things that require really fine motor movements are not always as practical in a really close quarter situation. And so that's my spiel on self-defense. If you have questions, I would be happy to answer them to the best of my ability, but I am not a lawyer, and I am not an expert, so there are definitely going to be things that I refer to other people. That's my disclaimer. I learned to knit, literally just to the knit stitch, when I was 8 years old. My grandmother taught me with some yarn that was actually not bad in terms of color. It was blue and white, and it was acrylic because I was an 8 year old and we didn't know if I was actually going to like knitting enough to make anything useful anyway. So it was better not to have a whole lot invested in it. I still have my very first pair of knitting needles in a drawer over there that's on my stash, and just about a year and a half ago, I decided that Frankie—oh gosh, I can never remember her last name—the 10-stitch blanket, and I'll put the name, and I'm gonna start doing real show notes, I promise. But the 10-stitch blanket, I looked for a tutorial for that, and then YouTube suggested me a podcast, and that was the Knit All the Things podcast, which is no longer running because Dear Cara ended up with not enough time, it seemed like, because she was going to school and juggling some other stuff. So anyways, but that was my very first knitting podcast, and then I watched Ellie and Dave of Effo and Die, they were my second podcast, and then it went from there to Kristen of Yarngasm and Denny Little Bobbin, so on and so forth, and I'll talk more about other podcasters later, because I love them all. And that's just it about me. There is a questions and comments thread in the Ravelry group, so I will sticky that to the top of the forums or discussion boards. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask. I'd love to chat with y'all. So, of course, now that I've started a new needle on this sock, it's time for me to talk about finished objects. So I'm just going to stick that safely out there so I don't drop stitches. I actually have three, but only two that I can show you. My first finished object for my first episode are my modified blueberry waffle socks. These are my March socks for the Yarngasm Box of Socks cow. And this is my very first opal yarn. Oops, sorry, not, here we go. Back in November, I participated in a swap hosted by Ellie and Dave of FO and Die. Hold it over here. Called a magic swap, and the theme was magic, obviously. It was kind of a round robin thing, so A would send to B, B would send to C, and C would send back to A in the most simplest form. And the person who sent me a package was Heidi. No, yes, Heidi, and she is Smooshy Bear on Ravelry, and I think it's the same on Instagram. Dear sweet Heidi. She sent the most amazing package, and this lovely opal yarn was in it. And this is the Siamese Fighting Fish, the Beta Fish colorway. It's called Mira. And it's the German word for secret agent. I can't remember it off the top of my head, and my book of ball bands is somewhere under the sofa that I'm sitting on, I believe. But I have two socks. They've been hanging out on blockers, but they're not washed yet. But that's okay. I'm gonna wear them tomorrow anyway, because tomorrow is St. Patrick's Day. And these are green, dang it. They are green. I understand that the vast majority is purple, gray, blue, but those green stripes are enough for me. That was my progress marker, more or less, on how much knitting I had achieved. These are 20 rows of 2x2 rib, and then instead of the standard 2 rows of stockinette and 2 rows of 2x2, I did 4 rows and 4 rows, so it's a little bit of a taller. I actually like it like this because it just, I don't know what it is so that I like so much, but I definitely like it. I love the heel on this because it's got this bright green stripe. Speaking of the heel, it is a, look how nice that looks off of the blocker. This is a standard slip stitch heel, just like that, followed by a standard heel turn, which I actually am going to do differently in my next pair of socks for me. I'm going to do a Dutch heel because I'm horrible with names, and of course I didn't write anything down, but I was watching the Grocery Girls today, and she just, not Jody, but the other sister, I'm so sorry, I don't remember, this is the first episode I ever watched, but she really, really loves the Dutch heel, and she says it gives you fewer gusset stitches to decrease, so I want to try that. But then this is my standard, gusset, this is the gusset from the Vanilla Orchid sock pattern, which is a paid pattern, so I can't tell you too much about what goes on in it, but, it's my favorite sock pattern, and I will provide a link to that. And then I just did a standard wedge toe, and for some reason this toe looks stupid. The Kitchener got all wonky, and I don't know, so I just kinda, I did some stitching to sort of make it look right and called it a day because I was not willing to try to figure out how to undo the Kitchener stitch and start over at the beginning. So, I'm going to put this back on its blocker. And this is 3 pairs for the Box of Socks cow. And I still don't have a box to put my socks in. So I need to work on that. My next finished object is a baby sweater for a friend. his due date, her due date, excuse me, the due date for her little boy was not supposed to be until April 20th, but she's actually had him a few weeks early. She had him sometime last week, I believe. And this is the snug bug pattern in I Love This Yarn Navy Tweed. I still have a fair bit of this left in the skein. I don't think it's quite enough for a whole sweater, but it definitely is enough for a good chunk of it. So I'm probably going to knit another baby sweater, because I have a teal yarn that is very similar to the color of this particular tweedy bit at the end of my middle finger there. And so I think those would look really cute together on a kind of stripy, sweater. I knit the 3 month size, so I'm hoping that it will fit the little boy for at least that long. I really think it will be longer because my gauge was a little loose, and I ended up with a slightly larger sweater than I think a 3 month old would fit. So there's that. It's one of those open front cardigan styles, so that it's easy to take on and off, and it's easy to, when the baby inevitably makes a mess like they do, you don't have to change the sweater and wash it 1,000 times. So there is that. My final finished object is something I'm not allowed to show you because it's a test knit for Jessie, who is yarn over in New York. But she is a genius, and she's coming out with a whole bunch of glorious things. She's also the one who wrote the pattern for my favorite socks, so you should go check out her Ravelry page. I'll include a link in the show notes. So next, we get to talk about works in progress. And since you saw these a minute ago, before I started talking about finished objects, these are the aptly named Captain America socks for Stephen. This is a 72 stitch sock, and there's 15 rounds of 2x2 rib. The leg, it's a short sock because I'm concerned. I had to cut the yarn because there was a knot, so I'm concerned about having enough yardage for these bigger socks. And so this is a 30 row leg standard. Slip stitch heel, which I just love. If I can straighten it out. I just love the way the color is patterned on here. There we go. You can see it perfectly. I love the way the color is patterned on here. I think that's awesome. And then I did my standard heel turn and gusset because that's what came naturally. And the last pair that I knit him were toe up, so he's not gonna know the difference between that heel turn and this one to it's not something a non-knitter would understand necessarily, I don't think. I think once he puts them on and says, yes, I like them, or no, they're too tight right here, or they feel weird here, I'll be able to better knit the next pair if/when that happens. Let's be honest here. 72 stitches is such a big sock. It's ridiculous. It feels like I'm taking forever to knit this sock. I got way more done than I thought I would, but definitely not as much as I would like to have done for having had this sock on the needles since Saturday, and it's now Wednesday evening. That also is contributed to by having slightly less time to work on them at work because customers are more demanding this week than they were the past couple of weeks while I was knitting my blueberry waffle socks. But yes, that is the cap sock, and I don't know that I like the way the pooling/flashing changed here. they're house socks, so, and if they do get worn in a shoe, nobody's gonna see it, so I doubt he'll care. But I really enjoyed the way it was flashing here, because it was wrapping this way in the cuff, and then it went back this way. As far as the red color goes, it went back this way in the leg. And I'm thinking it will probably do that again. It looks like it's starting to on this side, on the foot. But that mixy up area, I probably won't knit variegated socks very often, because I don't know that I love this. I love it when other people knit it. I just don't know that I love it when I'm knitting it. So that's Steven's sock. And this has been going to work with me in my Stolen Minutes bag. I cannot stop singing the praises for these bags. She's on Etsy, and she is glorious. There's her little tag, and they're awesome. She sent me this bag in a swap, and I love, 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 love it. My next project has been removed from its bag, but it is living in my Christmas bag from Debbie Reese of the Periscoping Sisters podcast. They just started, I think they put out 2 episodes. I think they're calling them skeins. Yeah, so it's mustaches and stripy polka dots, or polka dotty stripes, and then more polka dots. And this is a pretty roomy bag. This is definitely a shawl size, which is why it has 2 baby sweaters in it. The tweed one that I just showed you, and then the next one that I'm about to show you, which is the newborn vertebrae. I have split the sleeves, I've split the sleeves off, and I have started knitting down the back. This is Patton's Croy in the spring stripe colorway, and I've made a few mistakes on it, so I probably will keep this for when I eventually have my own children. Or I might keep it as like a, I might keep it as a, shop, model, not a model, a sample piece. So, if I ever carry Patton's Croy in my, dream yarn shop. But I'm really enjoying this. I know I'm not going to have enough for the whole sweater, because I took a bunch out for a square or two, I think, on my Cozy Memories / Bandwagon blanket. But, I actually am planning on knitting to a certain amount, or to a certain point on this, finishing the bottom in a solid black yarn, and then splitting whatever is left of the ball in 2, so that I can continue the sleeves just a little bit, and then finishing everything else in black. So I think it's going to be really cute when it's done. I can't wait to finish this, because I love these colors, and I'm really glad I didn't make socks out of them, because they would have been so short, because I only have the one ball. I got this yarn on super sale. It was like $2 a ball. I should have gotten 2, but what was I thinking? I don't know. Oh, you know what I was thinking? I had just knit my first pair of Rose City Rollers, and I was addicted to the pattern. And then I picked up another pair of socks, and haven't yet knit another pair of Rose City Rollers. So, but that is my newborn vertebrae. And I actually am enjoying the construction of this pattern enough that I might purchase the adult version so that I can make one for myself. Probably not in this colorway, though, because that would just, I think it would look weird on a larger scale. Pose, as Ellie and Dave call them, partial objects. And I have to fish this out of my unicorn bag from the same lovely Heidi. This was also part of my magic swap package. I love it. It's so roomy. I have 3 projects in this bag, one of which is my blanket. project number one. Not yet started. Gigantic bag of scraps for the blanket. Project number two, not yet started. And blanket. This bag is awesome. It has this pocket on the inside that is like the perfect size for my size 3 needles that I use. And there's, what do I have in here? I have a row counter and a couple of stitch markers. Just kind of knocking around in the bottom. So this is my blanket. It is sitting at 49 squares. And I love it to bits. I started at this corner. And then I did these two and this one. And I squared it off. I obviously have a fair bit of yarn left to go before I run out, but I'm always open to swaps. I have at least 3 in here that are definitely big enough for me to send a mini to somebody else. And then, special objects. Okay, we will talk about that stuff later. I'm surprised I'm only at 30 minutes. It should be a little shorter at this point because I'm going to edit it, I hope. As long as I don't corrupt the file like I did on my last attempt. But anyways. Spinning. My spinning. This is my Captain America fiber that I received, or that I purchased from Bakewell Hearts. And it is just wonderful. I think I have roughly 150 yards. I'd have to go look at Instagram, and double check. But look, just, let me fold it over one more time and just look at all those colors. Like, I really was concerned. I thought I was gonna have to Navajo ply it, and I just didn't want to lose the yardage, so I two-plied it anyway. I really was concerned that all these colors would just get muddy, or it would look too patriotic, which I know we're talking about Captain America here, but let's be real, people. But I'm really, really proud of this. This was roughly 1 ounce of fiber on my spindle, which I'm going to show you here in a minute with my next project on it. I'm not sure what it's going to be yet, because it is more or less a lace weight. There are some spots where it goes into fingering weight, but just look at how glorious it is. I just like the way I love the way that her roll legs are put together. She uses all the colors. I don't know. I have the same coral that Ellie did with her My Little Pony Rolex, which was, she found some snaggy spots, but I don't think that's enough to stop me from, don't mind me, I'm just being awkward here. I don't think that is enough to stop me from ever purchasing her fiber again, because I really did enjoy spinning it, and just, how can you resist those colors? And it's Captain America, guys! It just smells like wool, it hasn't been washed yet. Anyhow, let me reach over here. And this is where I'm gonna throw up my hashtag. Sorry, not sorry for the crinkling. Where's my spindle? There it is. So this is the spindle that I spun the last project on. Look at that pretty whirl. It's just a jewelry notion, I believe, on a chopstick, but it's really, really nice. It's really, really lightweight, and I am spinning super duper fine singles off of this puppy. So yeah, this is fiber that I received from Jess Ann of the Sheepish Grin. She's also on Etsy, but I don't think there's anything in her shop right now. But this girl has got an eye for color. Look at that turquoise and yellow. And then there's a pop of candy pink. And then one of these, there's a little bit of orange in there, but I don't know how well you'll see it. I want to say this was called Guppy Garden or something like that. It's a 1 ounce, or maybe it's just a little more than that, bat. And I basically have just, I pulled the bat into strips and stuck it all, rolled the little strips up into nests, and those are gonna get spun up eventually. My first 3 nights, I did one a night, and there was one night that I did two, and then I got lazy and haven't touched it since then. So yeah. I have so much other things to talk about. We're gonna start. I know where I'm gonna start. I'm gonna start by showing you, since we're talking about spinning, what else is on my spindle. That is this, which is actually about to come off because it's got to the point where my fiber is breaking every couple of minutes. This is a braid that I purchased from Rock and String Yarn a long, long time ago, and I love these colors. It's pretty much, you can see everything that's in there. It's pink and blue and gray. And I'm thinking I'm going to Navajo ply it to preserve the striping quality of it. I still have a little bit of fiber to go. So that will probably end up being a total of 3 skeins, and I'm not sure what it will be yet, but I'm hoping to get decent yardage, 300 yards maybe. Fingers crossed. So there's that. My next thing to discuss is I have been watching some lovely, lovely new podcasts, all in the sub 20 at this point, episodes. Yeah, because Legacy Knits, I think, just released episode 13, and they have the most so far. And Legacy Knits are Chelsea and Sue. Chelsea is the daughter and Sue is the mother, and they are wonderful. I love their energy and how they kind of just play off of each other and they enable each other. So if you're watching me and you haven't watched them, are you living under a rock? That sounded mean, I'm sorry. But seriously, you're missing out. You should go watch them if you have the time. Also want to give a shout out to Katie of the Inside Number 23 podcast. She is hosting a Harry Potter knit along at the moment, and I am thinking of casting something Phoenix themed with this for the knit along, because isn't it glorious? It definitely makes me think of fire and ashes, and it's gonna be awesome. This is my crazy zobber ball, by the way. Love it. And I resisted watching Katie for quite a while just because she pronounces her name Katie, and to me, as an American, and I think lots of people, but specifically Americans, definitely pronounce it Katie 90% of the time. On a completely unrelated note, 43.2% of statistics are made up on the spot. Anyhow, And so I just resisted her. I resisted watching her just because I felt like if I had to talk about her, I would feel bad if I mispronounced her name. But then Kristen started talking about her, and Stacy started talking about her, and then Ellie finally mentioned her, and I was just like, alright, you know what, I gotta see what all the hype is about. And she's adorable, and her pug is adorable, and she's just awesome, okay? And if you are not watching the podcasts that everybody is talking about, I mean it, you're missing out. Go check them out, because they're all glorious. Shannon, lovely Shannon of the Soxetera podcast, she is in Canada. I forgot to mention the Legacy Knits gals are in Connecticut, I believe. It's one of the tiny northeastern states, and being from Texas, let's be real, we could eat them all alive. Anyhow, I can't remember them saying off the top, and I think I started on episode 6 or 7 of their podcast, so I'm sure if I had started watching earlier, I would know. But anyway, Shannon is in Canada, and Shannon is hilarious. And Shannon is very down to earth, and it took me approximately 7 minutes into her very first episode for me to decide that I needed to subscribe to her channel. So I did! I thoroughly enjoy watching her. She has some very down to earth things to say about things like yarn snobbery and, stuff like that. So I mean, it was, I really enjoy watching her podcast, and she knits some beautiful things. She's hilarious. She's so hilarious. And she's not on my list, but Stacy. Lovely Stacy of Stress Knits, who is from Michigan or Minnesota, I believe. But I know for a fact she's at college in West Virginia. And she's just adorable too. She's, I don't know how she finds time to knit all the things that she does, but she does, and it's amazing. Stacy, you're my fave. You're all my fave. If I talked about you in this episode, you're my fave. But yeah, no, I started watching her because Kemper of the Junkyard podcast mentioned her several times, and I just decided, you know what, let's check it out. Once again, what's the hype about? And she's adorable, and she is hilarious. So is Kemper. Kemper's adorable and hilarious. Anyway, I love all the podcasters. I love watching podcasts. I'm always looking for new, glorious ones. So, if you know of somebody that I have not mentioned, on my list to watch is More Grocery Girls, Mina Makes, and Molly, Homespun House. So if they're not those three, and if you are not those three, holy cow, if you guys are watching me, I'm like mad honored. Let me know. I'm always looking for new podcasts to watch, because there's inevitably that one day in the week where I'm like, need knitting fix, and nobody has a new podcast out. I've seen everything. So that leads me to my newest section, that was totally not on, I talked about needle adjacency in the old podcast, but, this is inspirations as well as needle adjacent. Actually, let me pull it up on a tablet, because tablet, you can see better. I recently, saw in one of my Facebook groups a couple of things. So let me go pull up my message box. I'm so sorry. I was not 100% prepared. I was organized, but not prepared. I have a thread in the Ravelry group for this. Oh, and look at that. She was nice enough to include a picture. And I tagged, A.K. Rieg, or A. Krieg, I'm not sure how it's pronounced, but she knit a beautiful, amazing big water cowl out of what is called, it's a commercial yarn, but it looks like hand spun, or maybe it's a commercial dyer, and they actually did spin this yarn. Let me just get this image as big as it can, as I can. There we go. Look at this beautiful thing. It is so glorious, and it just looks so natural, and I'm going to knit one of these out of my hand spun, in various colors, because it's a free pattern. Free pattern alert! It just looks so good. It looks so good. And she was kind enough, after I magic linked her, to, post that picture in the thread. So that's my thread. So go check out the Ravelry group. And she does recommend, she said that she recommends a, provisional cast on and kitcheneuring the ends together instead of just seaming it, which provisional cast on scare me a little. So I'm not so sure. But the option is there. And then, let me open up. My next thing that I want to show you is I have downloaded this, which is one of Stephen West's free patterns. Ooh, blown out. Sorry, I didn't mean to blind you. And this is the Ferocious Briocious, which is so fun to say. I'm going to find a tutorial on how to knit brioche. I've heard that two-color brioche is actually easier than one color, so I may actually turn around and go to find the brioche scarf pattern instead. And this is also going to be, this is going to be for this bag of scraps. A bunch of stuff I've received from Flo, and then some of those are, my Beanie Bags, subscription that I won in a giveaway from the lovely NorCal Naptime, whose name I can't remember once again. But yeah. So there's that, and then there is this, which I died. I saw this was entered in Andy Andre Sunit's Shawl Along. This was in their finished objects. And look at it. It just looks so squishy and cozy and delightful. And the pattern, she says the pattern is getting released soon, but look, it looks like there are there's three shades of green and two shades of gray in it. I'm trying to avoid reflections. It's just not happening. It may just be one shade of gray that looks different because it's in front of her white shirt. But this, I'm going to be stalking this designer until I find the pattern and until it's been released, because it's glorious. It's glorious. I want it. I want it a lot. Finally, I of course have not got this one pulled up and ready because organized but not prepared. I'm sure you've seen this by now because everybody and their dog is knitting one because it is glorious. This I can't get it to zoom. I'm trying to zoom it. So there we go. Is that not the most beautiful thing? I have a skein of Madeline Tosh in the esoteric colorway. I think it's going to be just glorious once I scrape together the $6 to buy the pattern. It's so pretty. And it calls for a US 6 needle, which I happen to have one. I'm so excited to knit that. It's not even funny. So yeah, that is... Where's the off button? Am I flipping? Oh, I've managed to flip... Tell it lets you flip it upside down if you don't do the right thing. Learning new things every day. Anyhow, I just noticed that this and this would look delightful next to each other. I don't know why I'm mentioning this to you, but anyways, so yeah, that's really all I have at the moment. I didn't even make tea before I sat down or anything. I'm organized now, you guys, not prepared. So I will work on that for the next episode, which will not be... I'm going to continue my... even though it's the summertime now, I'm going to go ahead and continue my previous pattern from the last from the other podcast of recording on around midday on the weekend, because it's 7 o'clock on a Wednesday and I'm starting to lose light, and I know I'm not going to have the light when winter rolls back around. So, that said, I am going to shoot the right to bear yarn. I'm going to shoot for recording a minimum of every other week. But I can't make any promises just because my work schedule and drill schedule always coincide against me. So, that said, I would love to hear from you guys, and I would love to know who my viewers are. As always, it means so much to me that you guys like what I have going on here enough to hit that subscribe button, and that you want to see me again, except for Brianna, because you've been subscribed since before I was making videos. I love you! anyhow, yeah, so thank you guys so much. Thank you for putting up with my shenanigans with my new podcasting, and thank you for putting up with the shenanigans with the old podcast, not having a name for over a year. And I will see you guys next week. Oh, no. 2 weeks. It's this weekend and a drill, so next weekend. Unless, of course, the fates are planning against me, which I don't doubt that they are in terms of podcasting. But anyhow, I love you guys so much for stopping by, and thank you for putting up with this punny name. I love it, and it's not going away. I think I am brilliant. I'm so proud of it. And that's my blurb. So yeah, thank you guys so much. Have a great week. Or two. Bye!